So we are going live, so I'll start this session.
Okay.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Premjish Achari, and I'm heading the programs and editorial for the exhibition Lokame Tharavadu, a global survey exhibition of contemporary Malayali artists from Kerala, India, and abroad, curated by Bose Krishnamachari and organized by the Kochi Biennale Foundation. And this is a series of discussions we are having as part of the central theme of the exhibition called The World is One Family, and where we are attempting to interrogate the idea of home, belonging, identity. And in each panel, and this is the 10th panel, and in each panel we bring together the artists who are part of the exhibition. And also at times we also bring in experts from different areas, such as previously we had J. Devika, we had Deepan. So there are different people and experts from different walks of life who also contribute to the discussion. And in today's discussion, we have three artists who are part of this particular exhibition. Manoj Vyloor is here with us, Supriya, Menon, and Suneetha, Kodamana. Three of them are here, and I will briefly introduce three artists to you. Manoj Vyloor is born in Ernakulam, Kochi, and he lives and works in Kochi and Trivandrum. And currently, he's the principal of College of Fine Arts at Trivandrum since 2020. He studied in the College of Fine Arts Trivandrum and received a BFA degree in painting in 1995. He's also studied graphics printmaking in the Faculty of Fine Arts Baroda. He has received a MA in graphic arts in 1997 and also studied in the National Superior de Beaux Arts in Paris for a short period on a French government scholarship in 1996-97. And Manoj has also been prolifically, he's been prolifically showing and doing exhibitions, and he also has six solo exhibitions to his credit, which also includes a diverse artistic output, which are shown in Cochin, Paris, Baroda from 1996 to 2020. And I hope there will be more shows for us to see in the coming days and coming years. He's also been part of various group exhibitions and art camps at different places in India and abroad, and also has received Honorable Mention Award of Kerala Lalit Kala Academy in 2000. His works are there in the collection of Kerala Lalit Kala Academy and in the private collections in India and abroad. He has also worked as a curator of the Students' Biennale 2021. And in the coming days, as part of the Interrogating the Art Pedagogy, we will be having a discussion around the last edition of the Students' Biennale. So good to have you here, Manoj. And Manoj is also, he was also a member of the General Council of the Kerala Lalita Kala Academy between 2007 and 2010. And also he served as a member of the Board of Studies in Applied Art, University of Kerala between 2009 and 2012. And currently from 2020 onwards, he's still the member. Thank you, Manoj, for joining us today. And I welcome you to this panel. Supriya Menon is a ceramic artist living and working in Auroville near Pondicherry. Her initial learning in ceramics was with Ray Meeker and Deborah Smith at the Golden Bridge Pottery in Pondicherry. And later with the Charles Wallace Award, she further explored ceramics with Sandy Brown in Devon, UK. She has participated in numerous workshops with renowned ceramists from around the world and in artists in residence programs from the Europe, South Korea, and in India. In 2004, she lost her studio because of the tsunami. And after that experience, she began to study Ikebana with Valeria Raso Matsumoto. And this led to a study and practice of creation with nature and working together with nature. So the work which resulted out of this called the seed boards, which are part of the collection at the Kleark Gimhae Museum in South Korea, and Red Days, another series of work, is in the collection of MIC, Museo Internazionale Ceramic in Italy, the International Museum of Ceramic in Italy. And Supriya has also curated ceramic exhibitions called the Deccan Teapot Show, Earthbound in Auroville, and Ceramic Connect, an Indo-Korean ceramic show in Chennai. And from 2016, she curated the exhibition Krita Yuga, 2018 Auroterra, showing the works of Indian ceramists for Argilla, a ceramics biennale from Italy, 2020 in the box, which has been postponed to 2022. That is the upcoming show, I think. Right, Supriya? Is that the upcoming show?
Yes.
Okay, all the best for that. And
thank
you for joining us today. And I welcome you to this panel and look forward to hear more from you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And today we have we have a professor today, and we have a doctor today also with us. We have Dr. Suneetha Kodamana, who is also born in Kerala, and she did a double master's degree in Sanskrit and Malayalam literature. And she has followed her passion for art and theater by doing a PhD in Sanskrit literature from Calicut University, Kerala. And I think Calicut has a very, if you don't know, Calicut has a very strong Sanskrit research going on. And I have also been benefited a lot from the research which is going on in the Calicut University, especially on the textual sources, the Shilpa Shastras, which are written in the medieval period from Kerala. So it's a very, very good department. And she moved to Delhi in 1990, where she later developed her interest in art and learned how to sculpt and got into art practice with the fellow artist MJ Enos. Suneetha has also been part of various group shows and a solo show in Delhi, and also right now part of the Lokame Tharavadu exhibition. And what she is in Delhi right now. Thank you, Suneetha, for joining us. And it's wonderful to have you.
Thank you so much.
Okay, Manoj, so let's start with you. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Premjish. I hope I'm audible.
Yes.
Yeah. Let me first, even though Boss is not joined today, let me first both congratulate as well as thank Bose for organizing such a wonderful exhibition and also inviting me for this session of the discussion. Well, about the question of where I belong or where I come from. Well, it seems a very simple, straightforward question, but on a second thought, it unfolds many several thoughts inside, you know, what I mean, also about who I am, I mean, where I'm going to, or what I will, what I'll be doing, I mean, or maybe what I'll be ending up, you know. So several questions comes up, and maybe I think if I am, if someone wakes me up in the middle of a deep sleep and ask me the same question, I don't know. I don't know exactly what I'm going to answer at that moment. I don't know whether I'll have an answer at all. You know, maybe that may be the real moment when the right answer might you know, come from you inside. You know, when you are asked unexpectedly this question. But consciously, maybe this question maybe related maybe to your lineage, to your language, to your geography or history, or to demography or to genetic, you know, like where do you really come from or where do you really belong to? And but beyond this, I draw heavily from the renowned filmmaker, director Andrei Tarkovsky when I'm answering such a question. I mean, do artists belong to a place really? I mean, or do we really find a place for ourselves? You know, that's a major question. So I believe, like in the movie called Stalker, I mean, there is this place called Zone. I mean, or it's not a place, all, maybe it's not a place also. Maybe some time, I mean, or some memory where actually a creative person might try to linger or maybe even try to, you know, find a place for himself or herself. So I think Zone is somewhere actually an artist come from when it comes to art and creativity. So and this time, you know, I believe that Zone is somewhere in the border of real and unreal. There's this thin border, I mean, this thin line that divides the real and unreal. So maybe I might seem a bit metaphysical or, you know, but I don't wish to be very, philosophical, because many had interpreted this question very philosophically, but this is more from me as an artist. And today, as we live, I mean, we see a lot happening around. I mean, there's life happening at the microscopic level as well as on the macrocosmic level. And we don't know where really we are placed or where really we are, really living it actually. And I think it's a matter of yourself finding or carving a place for yourself. I mean, so that's why I always quote go back to what Tarkovsky said. And when I'm speaking about this, several thousands of people are getting evacuated from their homes, or you know, maybe thrown out of their homes, or maybe even asked to leave their homes or their belongings at this very moment. So whenever we think of a place like home or we have an idea of home, it is also something very painful. I mean, because we all lose that at some point of time. I myself, you know, in 2008 or 2009, actually, the home where I lived until I was 35, I mean, the home where I was born and maybe brought up, we had to leave that home on our own decision to a new place. I mean, we built a new home. But actually, I tell you, the new place is just a house and not a home yet. And whatever I lived, I mean, as a young child or all those years with my parents or, you know, and the nature around, is still lingering in me as a home. And I think that is going to live with me as a pain inside. So I think one of my colleague, a teacher, an old a teacher who was teaching Sanskrit, I mean, when he got a transfer to another school, I mean, that this was many years ago. And he said, I breathed the air and ate the fruits of this place. So he said he belongs to this place. So in a way, the place or the geography actually lives inside the person. I mean, so the same way, I think I also think about my home as somewhere living inside me, somewhere inside me. And also, I would like to quote from Marquez. I think Marquez, sometime in an interview, when he was asked which place he considered as his homeland, I mean, or his home, I remember it faintly. I mean, he said, home is a place where you desire to die. I mean, or maybe, not all people are fortunate enough to decide that. I mean, but somewhere where you wish you died, I mean. So that means somewhere where you leave back your memories. And that is something maybe Marquez might have said. And I think it's quite a good, answer to that question. And maybe I'll go to my slides. I mean, so that maybe I can show the words. I hope it is visible. So, in fact, this is the blatant answer I have for the question. Between the real and the unreal is where I am from. And in 2016, I did this solo exhibition in Durbar Hall, and it was the exhibition was titled as Losing Home, and it was a response to the 2013 Syrian crisis, when people from Syria had to fled to mainly Europe because of the chaotic situation happening in Syria and in nearby places. It really left a big vacuum or maybe a big wound inside me, seeing all those people leaving the places, maybe not reaching their place or place, any destiny. So this is a 50 feet long installation I did in 2016, early 2016. It actually, this is almost a kind of a narrative on cadres on a platform, or maybe it is kind of a shelf where I started with a simple home, getting chaotic or maybe becoming more several problems sitting inside, and then later on becoming kind of a war or battle, and being the whole place or your home being invaded by someone else whom you don't know, from some outsiders, and the whole people having to fled their homes, which I think is the biggest problem happening around in the world, actually, and which actually is the biggest the wound or the pain every human being might face in their life. I mean, leaving your home or maybe losing your home. So, and in this Lokame Tharavadu exhibition, I am showing several small drawings. I mean, this is very different from what I just showed, or maybe what I said. But as an artist, I always go back to that zone or to that thin line that I draw between the real and the unreal, and try to explore where I am from or where I belong. And I try to narrate certain things which are which happen between consciousness and maybe my subconscious. And these are some of the drawings. Maybe these may come out as some works later on. But I personally can't explain what these are. But these drawings actually are coming somewhere inside me, which I believe is that zone or the place where an artist belongs. And some stories which might have lingered inside for long, or some stories you make. So small drawings, A5 size drawings. And this was done in 2009, and it had another work along with it, which is not included in this show. This painting was titled Private Citizen. Maybe after 2005, when the market boom happened all over the world, I mean, there were many people buying or maybe trading land, and maybe throwing out the people who lived there for long, and acquiring those land, and becoming masters of the land, and that is also again a crisis. I mean, how do you determine who you are when your own home is lost and then someone else lives there? And this work, in this work, I just wanted to, in a way, depict someone who has mastered a new place, and he's, enjoying what is conquered, or what is bought. And this another painting in the show. Again, this is again a drama or kind of a melodrama inside a home, maybe a bit cinematic. This can be someone saving someone else from an accident, or maybe it can be even a kidnap kind of thing. So for me, home is a paradox. I mean, there are many dramas and melodramas that happen, and you are not sure whether your home itself is your home, and sometimes you also feel kind of homesickness at home. And this is a paradox. When you are at home, sometimes you are not sure whether you are still at home. And this is a painting which I did particularly for this show, Lokame Tharavadu. I titled it as Memoriam, a tableau. Coming back to Andrei Tarkovsky, when he said that art is beyond all boundaries, or maybe it transcends all whatever divides us. and it pierces or conquers hearts. So to me, whether there is no, divide between the West, the East, or the South, or the North, I think in my domain, this all comes, in my art, all this comes in a confluence, So here on the left, you may see a common person from Kerala, or, he was one of my favorite model in Trivandrum here. And on the right, you may see a beautiful lady from Titian's painting, and maybe different several references. And I am somewhere placed as an artist in between this, between the real and maybe the imaginary, or the fantastic. And my art happens when these things come to together or into one place. So just showing you the size of the work and maybe some details. And actually, my idea of art, or my artistic practice, is when there is a tension between two or more than two things, and you are caught in between. So I feel home when I'm anxious, really, when I have that anxiety in me. And these are some small works. I call them my silhouette paintings. Again, these, I believe, again, coming from that zone somewhere inside me. And yes, these are two small paintings, again, from my silhouette painting series. And this was done in 2018 when there was this heavy flood in Kerala. And we saw several, happenings, sad happenings in television and in newspapers. So above, you see people escaping or trying to escape the flood. And below, you see a family returning to their home, or maybe there is no home back to return back, but still somewhere inside us, we all return back to that home one day or the other. So maybe home is a poetic space or poetic time, or maybe a zone somewhere that resides inside us. So I think that's what I wish to say. I think I made my point in the time given. Thank you.
Thank you, Manoj. Thank you for that wonderful presentation, and also taking us in this oscillation between the real and the unreal, and also introducing this new idea, the new concept of the zone. And I hope that we will get more time to discuss that and develop this particular idea too. And also directing the discussion again towards homelessness. And why? The question, where are you from, as you pointed out, that it is not a question to answer, but there are a lot of context to it, this question. And one of the important question context is the contemporary political turbulence, where the slogan of this is not your home becomes very important, where you pointed out rightly displacement, people forced out of their homes due to various reasons, due to the rise of various political configurations. And home becomes at the center. Home stands at the center of this global political drama, intimate moments, theatricality, like you said, melodrama and everything. Home is kind of holding on, or home is built with all these elements. And thank you for highlighting all these issues. And we will discuss and take up some of these issues. And I would like to ask you, so you have time to think about, there's a lot of discussion about home and homelessness. And I would like to ask you, and you also talked about zone, that does art offers home? Does art provides a home? Or art leaves you in the zone? Well, what does art do to you? Maybe you can answer when we come back to the moderator discussion. Okay, Suneetha, please start your presentation.
I think she's muted.
Pardon?
Sorry, now we can hear you. Please, you'll have to start again because you were muted.
Hi, good evening. I'm very grateful for this opportunity. I was really interested in the idea of Lokame Tharavadu. In Sanskrit, the full saying goes by verse, I am Nijak Paro Vedi Ganana Deku Chetasam Udara Charidanam Tu Vasudeva Kudumbagam. It says, this is mine, that is his, says small mind. The wise believe that the entire world is family, a family. One more similar version is there in Upanishad, Yatra Vishyam Bhavati Eganidam, means the whole world is a bird's nest. Rabindranath Tagore adopted this idea and started his institution in the name of Yatra Vishyam Bhavati Eganidam in the earlier time. And it is become Vishwabharati and extended to Shantinikethan. Vasudeva Kudumbagam and Eganidam concepts and similarities are same. And it extends into affecting not only mind, but the overall psychological, physiological, and spiritual states of mind. Are you able to see the screen?
Yeah, now it is opening. Give it a few seconds.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. We'll just make it full screen.
Okay. When it comes to where I am from, I come to analyze that we come across two dimensions, that is philosophical and practical. In a radical way, I can say my first home is my mother's womb. Again, I can say my body is the home of my soul and senses. This senses reveals to me, you are from India, you are from Kerala, you are from Thrissur, you are from Kadangod village, and you are from this religion and particular caste, and finally narrows down to that you are a woman. Slowly, I experience myself, I am a marginalized woman in our society. This mental struggle helped me to search the womanhood in me and fellow woman friends. As a teenager, my experience at home, where I was born and brought up, was a feeling of being trapped and oppressed space because I couldn't tolerate the gender hierarchy. During my university studies, I was staying in hostel. There I realized that my home was not my parental home alone, but the places wherever I lived and experienced a comfortable living environment. In this period, I used to write poems in Malayalam as a medium to express myself. Later, I met Inas and started living together in Delhi, where it was entirely different scenario of home. There I started learning to create sculptures where I could transfer my poetic images and expression, which gave more satisfaction and fulfillment. All of us belong to a large universal family, even if we become part of a marginalized sect of people. When I was traveled to Europe and stayed with many German friends, where I again felt a feeling of home away from home. In a way, the mutual relationship of the concept of what is within me is what is within you. That evokes the positive energy which leads to a feeling of at home. As a participant of this show, Lokame Tharavadu, where I get space to express my thought and feelings through my works, which gives some comfort to my soul. That also creates homely feelings among the fellow artists. In short, I'm in pursuit of, like Paul Gauguin's painting title, where do we come from? What are we? Where are we going? So I would like to show my major works. Yeah, this is called Birth of Man. It is life size in fiberglass. It is a portrayal of Mother Earth and the divine feminine. It is also an attempt to show the very same divine feminine being marginalized and objectified in majority of the places. This image shows the importance of a corner. This work needs a corner space for the display. A cornerstone represents foundation of a house, and edge. The corner remains unnoticed once the house is built, same as woman in the society or at home. This is a grieving lady. Yeah. This one is more than life size fiberglass, titled I Believe I Can Fly. Trying to show the confidence and an inner urge of a woman. This composition is based on a metaphor titled Marriage Institution. This work inspired from an incident happened in Mumbai at the time of New Year celebration, where the crowd started molesting a woman in front of her husband. It was a shocking incident. It reflects to me like a tusker rampage into the mob. This work also metaphorically represents the sexual violence. Yeah. Through this image, I try to bring out the socio-economic gender hierarchy system. This was done in a sculpture symposium with the help of stone carvers at Ahalya campus, Palakkad, based on Chilappadigaram. I really enjoy working with various mediums. All these works are done by myself. It is really a challenging process, which I enjoy so much. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Suneetha. Thank you for this presentation and also opening up discussions on womanhood and the marginalized position of women in configuration to home and society. And it is an important discussion, and also the attempts of women artists to find alternative homes, not individually, but also as a collective. And it reminded me of an exhibition which was curated in the 1970s by Judy Chicago and Miriam Shapiro. And the exhibition was called as The Woman House, where they rented out a house in the Hollywood. And along with their students, as part of the course, along with their students, they completely transformed the how that particular house into an exhibition space without the help of anybody else outside. So all the female students and these two faculty members, they did all the physical work of that exhibition, which was also to, in a way, to challenge the stereotypical understanding that women can't do heavy lifting, heavy work, heavy physical labor, and mainly that's why they keep away from such heavy mediums like sculpture. And women also don't take their job seriously, and after their MFA, they just get married. So it was also an attempt to challenge these kind of belief system. And so it reminded me of that. There is this oscillation between or a dialogue between the particular experience of the marginal versus the aspiration to be a part of a universal equal identity, that you want to become part of the one, a universal space, which is also an equal space of equal identities, while also retaining your own social agency, while also retaining your individual individuality also. And this is where I would like to also ask you, you could answer in the next, when after Supriya's presentation is over, when we go to the question answer session. While looking at womanhood and home, can home, like especially in relation to that sculpture where this woman is attempting to fly onwards, can home make you fly? Or does it trap you? What does home do? To think about it, and we can have a discussion about it. Supriya, over to you right now. You have to unmute, Supriya, and start again.
I think I have unmuted, yeah. Am I fine? Can you hear me? The one question that is asked to me very often is like, where are you from? Which part of the world are you from? And that's very interesting because I'm like, I could be from so many different places. And then when the answer is Kerala, it's, are you really from Kerala? So I need to make this for the record. Yes, both my parents are from Palakkad. My father was in the army. So we moved houses, homes every 2 years. And saw different cultures, different languages. And that was a great education experience. But almost every year, we went to our matriarchal home in a small village in Palakkad, which was another very interesting life, because that was like, this is your home. This is where your roots are. This is where your ancestors come from. And wherever you go, this is where you belong to. It's like, there is invisible umbilical cord that is connected to this land, which gives a very positive confidence. And I'm grateful for that. I don't read or write Malayalam. I speak all right, I guess. And then I went on to study and later wanted to have a place which is where I could stay for a while. And I found Auroville. And for me, like, yes, a home is belonging, but it is something more than belonging, because it's like to be at home with one's name, my nose, my skin, my shape. And that is a struggle. It takes time to overcome all this. And that happens when you accept it. And I think belonging is great, but one needs to accept it. Like, in a family, in a community. And it's like when Bose invited me for Lokame Tharavadu, I felt accepted by Kerala. I was like, oh, I belong and I'm accepted, you know? And that I'm really thankful for. And well, right now where I live in Auroville, it's an international township initiated not by founding fathers, but by a woman named Mira Alfasa, also called the mother. And the purpose of Auroville is human unity, which is, again, not an easy one. It is something that one can try in a small way to contribute to and try. That's it. For me, like what I'm going to show today is two parts of my body of work. One is called the nomadic life, which is like the amount of many houses that I've moved in and out. Like even the house I presently live in, I have outgrown and I need to find a new home, which is inevitable that I have to do. And it's fine because this is the life we lead today. And the other part is the womb series, which is a mold that I made of my pregnant belly. And it's a body of work for the last 17 years. And my experience as a motherhood, which is shown on these forms that comes through. And the womb is our very first home. And for me, all these elements like matriarchy, mother, womb, these have sparkled the feminine, the search for the feminine. And this is not, I would say, belonging to a gender. It is genderless because it's an essence. Like when I was a child, my father was more of a mother to me. And today I live with my mother, you know, so I'm blessed. So here's my slides that I would like to show you. So this is the very first thing that came out from the mold. I took it, these are all high-fired ceramics, 5 to 1300 degrees, some with wood, some with gas. This is by wood. And I wanted to have a sacred feeling to this because for me, womb is like where the male and female energy has come together to create life. And that is the most sacred of all. Can we go to the next? I think these are, again, I try to, you know, have a little symbolic sacredness in it. We can move faster, it's fine. Again, I was trying different techniques, different firing techniques and different making. And this, I started turning the pot, you know, upside down and making a small wall. This one is the Anagama fire, the piece, which is 3 days of fired with casuarina wood and the ash creates these colors. This is earthenware close up. And then the walls have started growing, you know, in time. And then they actually they started growing higher and higher and started to close at one point. It's almost like the motherhood has gone through all these stages. You can go to the... This is another part of. Yeah. These are the inside of the. The next one is the nomadic life, the seed pod series. I make them small and then work on them to make them bigger. So this was at Kleak in South Korea. This is earthenware, coil built. And this is recent ones. This is moving on to something more that from the home, it's going a bit more personal into my life. And this is one of my favorite pieces, a very feminine piece called Red Days. Thank you.
Thank you, Supriya. Thank you. And very interesting that you talked about belonging and acceptance, which are very crucial. Yes. I think to the formation of identity and a certain sort of connection and fixity. And I think artistic practice is also something which constantly yearns for this belonging and acceptance, always seeking communities. Even now, when we talk about the medieval travel writers, I'm talking about the European writers, it said that they were always looking out in search of a community. They were looking out to build a community of writers, to move around, find people, and imagine homes, find new homes, and seek out newer communities. And one important discussion which has come out of these panels is that is to interrogate whether art has been able to offer that home. And that's what I also asked Manoj, like, is art a home for him? Is art a zone for him? Similarly, you being to all these, living in all these places, like Auroville, Kerala has this place of transit where maybe you visit or like you stay for some time. Again, you've been like throughout India in your childhood and all. How has that shaped belonging? Because it could also unsettle somebody. Somebody who has been in Kerala for 40 years, 50 years without moving anywhere, and somebody who has been constantly traveling, and especially an artist, a creative person, it totally reconfigures the idea of belonging, the idea of identity, what is a native place. All these questions are challenged. And luckily, the art comes to rescue, because one can channelize all these provocative questions, all these traumas, troubles, happiness too, into the creative process. So how does art have enabled you to access, process these questions? Will be something to begin with. Manoj, you can start, and then Suneetha, and then Supriya, you can take this question and think about it and answer.
Well, your question whether art can be an alternative home. Well, art offers a lot of comfort, but it also offers a lot of pain to every artist. So I can say yes and no to that question. The zone which I referred is a place where a creative person can get lost and maybe find a lot of can do a lot of terrible mistake, and maybe you don't come back from the zone. As for me, I mean, when I said that, I meant that this is a place which every artist carries, in fact, and it's not very physical. It's psychological, or maybe it is even more physiological. I read a lot of Lenu Ramendran's writings, where he says, like, the feeling of God, the home is also somewhere a spot inside your brain. A feeling, or maybe it's centered somewhere inside your physical body, which surfaces sometimes and makes you feel home, at home. And so for an artist, when he is at, when he or she is, or maybe when the artist is at his height of creativity, I think that's a feeling of home to me. That's when you feel like you are in the right place, and maybe you are somewhere in a faraway place, or maybe you are amid a lot of troubles. But still, when you are at work, and when you are really trying to do a work, and you're finding the right rhythm, I think that's what I feel like home. And maybe I like to have a lot of anxiety as a pressure to work, or a lot of questions that comes to mind and keeps on disturbing me. So art definitely is a shelter. That offers a lot of comfort as well as a lot of challenges. And I remember, you know, Michael Jackson, the famous singer, once even saying like he feels the dance floor or the stage his home. I mean, place where he perform. Or, I mean, he feels that his home more than where he actually go and sleep. Or you know. Or maybe spend his time, his evening time with his family or anything. So for an artist, definitely that place where you know you are really finding a kind of artistic anxiety. I think that is more of a home. So art definitely is an alternative home. And more than that, you know, many artists have lived in other places, you know, faraway places where they were. They never felt that they will ever, go or, you know, get settled. But even then, they kept on having an idea of a home or maybe their homeland. And but it never came into their work often. So it's not necessary that in art you have to have a consciousness of your home or even homeland or where you belong. It's something you carve or you make. You make a home from what you have. I mean, like the way we all do our work. I mean, we make from things, whatever we are provided. So it's more of the given. It's more of the choice. More than the given now sometimes. You know, you can make out, you can make up a place or, you know, and make it a home. Thank you.
Thank you, Manoj. Thank you. I was also thinking when you from your response, nomadism is a very crucial phenomenon, even in modernism and also contemporary art, especially with the rise of biennales across the world, artists traveling. Earlier, it used to be a non-institutional kind of travel where artists were finding places, exploring, experimenting. And creating new avenues, homes, collectives, and also finding newer artistic meanings. And like in Suneetha's presentation also, she talked about Gauguin's work. And we know that what Gauguin's explorations. And similarly, like even in modernism and right now, nomadism is a very crucial aspect of contemporary art practice, which is not what I won't call it impulsive or what you call something which is coming out organically, but requirement which has become part of the contemporary global art world, that you need to travel to be visible, you need to travel to exhibit and all, which is a different sort of traveling. And on the other hand, we have this sort of fixity where artists are rooted in their own identity, their own language, their own state or their own place and work from there. Where do you see yourself in this? Where do you see your practice? Because also in your practice, it is about Syria. It is about refugee crisis. It is about the larger geopolitical questions. And where is it seen? It is seen in Kerala. Yes, we are aware of Syria through the newspapers and all, but when an artist from Kerala depicts the Syrian crisis, he's also offering his solidarity to that particular issue. So between this nomadism and this fixity, where do you see yourself?
Well, art happens mostly when you are compassionate or when you have a lot of empathy for the life around or the people around it, their situations. So it any person having a pain, whether it's she is in America or maybe in Europe or maybe in Far Eastern, I mean in Japan, or, you know, if you are a true artist, I mean with conviction, and you have an empathy, or you know, definitely your mind travel from here to that, to there, you know. Wherever you feel people, or maybe even enjoying life, I mean, you want to, you know, I mean, in a way, psychologically or mentally travel from here. I'll tell you my experience. You know, every year we go to see this film festival in, I mean, Trivandrum, IFFK. And when you are there, I mean, when you are watching each movie, you're traveling. I mean, maybe you're sitting inside the theater, but along with the movie, you are traveling maybe to Sweden or maybe to Argentina or maybe to, you know, Korea. And you feel you are there, you know. And maybe that's what an artist is. I mean, you travel, I mean, by your heart, I mean, by your imagination, and not just places on this globe or on this earth, maybe even beyond that. I mean, sometimes you get to, you know, have dreams or some visions, which is even beyond earthly. I mean, beyond, you know, our normal experiences. So I think I already said that life is happening both at the microcosmic and macrocosmic level, which we don't really experience or we don't see them. And so, for instance, the COVID, it's happening in the microcosmic level, and we don't have see it happening, I mean, or maybe spreading or, you know, or maybe receding. So same way, far away, when we are talking now, maybe a very large universe is now born, or maybe a star is bursted, or, you know, something happening far away. And still we say that we are living in real reality, and we are understanding reality, while you know, in most cases actually we are not. So traveling, to me, these days I am physically not at all traveling, not because of COVID, but otherwise also being because of the job, and, you know, and basically I you know, happen to live in Ernakulam and Kochi for a long time now. And I read, you know, heard about artists like Ganesh Pine, who hardly left Calcutta, or maybe he went to Banaras once or twice. Otherwise, he never traveled. But the works, you know, they go beyond all that. I mean, maybe transcends all that geographical, you know, places or anything like that. I mean, so physical travel is not that important for me. When you talk about nomadism, or yes, it is happening around the world. People try to break the, you know, the boundaries that divide countries, the, you know, the language barriers and all that. People deliberately trying to do that because of their loss of faith in the current world situation, or the world, I mean, the system of the different countries, and, you know, the rules that each country imposes on the people. Maybe everyone wants to become someone on, I mean, a person of this planet. So that is, and also there is also an apocalyptic feeling among people, like the world is not going to be like this anymore for long. So I've heard several travelers from Japan traveling, walking through Andes Mountains, you know, places, very faraway places, to see this for the last time, this earth. Because they feel, you know, this world is going to end. You know, maybe we are all at the beginning of that end. And so nomadism definitely is a very meaningful thing if it is going to actually unite people from different places, you know, by that. So I really accept that. And then settling to a place, is another thing. We have seen people, you know, really trying to, people who are tired, you know, tired of displacement, wanting to find a small corner, or maybe, you know, somewhere, they may say, somewhere I want to sleep, you know, and maybe under a tree, or maybe under a bridge, or, you know, maybe just by a brook. So there are people, I mean, who are also really, I mean, wanting to rest, you know, and find that you know, that the poetry of life. So these two are happening, you know, side by side.
Thank you, Manoj. Thank you, Suneetha. Please, what is your response?
Yeah, archives, you know, lots of pleasure, and sometimes we can forget the so-called conventional life, and you know, so means it gives some satisfaction when we fully, you know, involved with the doing this, you know, work. So in that way, what I can express, it is a very personal pleasure. I can, well, I'm always, you know, thing with my husband, two daughters, then I'm really tired of this home, and sometimes cleaning, cooking, everything. Just sometimes I feel I want to run away from this house, then go to studio and do the work. So that kind of feelings, then I get some satisfaction and I involve fully into the work, you know. So my personal experience
in that case, do you think studio is your home
at that yes, time? Of course, you know, when they go to school after 8 o'clock, I will be free. Then I'm very happy to go and, you know, enjoy the studio and, you know, whatever I want to do or think or sit there and, you know, see that kind of feelings that we cannot say, we cannot share, you know, means it's a real personal, you know, enjoyment. That gives lots of satisfaction. I can forget everything about my daughters or husband or this house, means the four walls and roof, you know, that space. Totally, I don't want to think of that space. See, that kind of a personal pleasure and home is this kind of feeling of sometimes tension, stress and all, no? But studio gives lots of positive energy. That kind of feelings I have. Then I traveled in Europe. That was in first time 1997. Documented time for castle. That time it was a refugees, lots of refugees was there. That time it was a Sri Lankan conflict was that time I was in Germany. Then my colors and features are less just like, you know, Sri Lankans. Then lots of people ask, are you from Sri Lanka? They think, you know, they thought I am a refugee. So in that way, I really, oh, this is, you know, Sri Lanka. I am from India. My, I know, life and my thoughts are entirely different from these refugees, and you know that their life is entirely different from their, you know, from their land. So that was, I felt, where is we can, you know, share, we can, sometimes we come to the same platform. Some conflicts, as a woman, I can share the Sri Lankan woman or Indian woman, some space, we are the same stage, mental stage is same. So in that way, art or travel or, you know, this makes some kind of painful. Painful means the sense of politically, economically, and, you know, it's not what we call really very stressful, really stressful thing, you know. We can't reach, we can't, you know, we can't give a definition of what is this, what is that, you know. We just feeling and sharing things to which there are like-minded people, the same wavelength people. We are always sharing, oh, there is, you know, that woman, she is, you know, suffering. That kind of home feelings, you know, mentally we are the same level. We are, you know, having the same tension. So that kind of, that space is sometimes, it was in Germany or Kerala or in Delhi, are the same. The platform is the same. Only the space and people face is different. But they, you know, their life is almost same because of the framework, you know, all the women are, most of the women are living in the same frame. They cannot come out, you know, out of the frame or out of the box. So that's why they are, suffering, but they have the dream to come out and I want to do that and this, but I don't know, somehow they cannot do it. Then, you know, socially the woman, they have the, in society, utopian culture is there. Woman must be that. And you know that Malayalam song, Pumukavadikal. That Malayalam song is, you know.
Yes, yeah, so those who don't know, it is a Malayalam popular song, which means that
Pumukavadikal. See, that kind of concept still is in Kerala. So they want to come out on that, you know, concept, but they know they cannot do it. But even then, they are standing, you know, in that space only. So this is a little bit, conflicts, feelings. Inside, they want to freedom, but outside, they cannot come out. So still they are struggling, you know, they are very tense and they are not happy at all. I talked with many friends and they have the same story. So where we can say the home means what kind of feelings they, you know, gets. Home means some kind of safety feelings or protection feelings. Many, many where they are give some definition. But in my case, I'm not that kind of woman. So I just jumped out of the, you know, that out of box, you know, I can say. So then I freely, I think, and you know, whatever I feel, I can do, wherever I want to go, I can go. That kind of life I chose. So then I am very, free mind to do sculpture or, you know, sometimes one of our neighbor asked me, Mole, ee challa kolache. ഇങ്ങനെ ഷെയിമല്ലേ നമുക്ക് മലയാളീസിനെ ഇവരെ എഡ്യൂക്കേറ്റഡ് വുമൻ വല്ല ജോലിക്കും പോയിക്കൂടെ സി ദർ ഫീലിങ്സ് ദിസ് ക്ലെയിം മീൻസ് ഫോർ ദം ഇസ് ചള്ള സോ ദൻ ഹൗ കൻ ഐ നോട്ട് സേ this is a sculpture or I am, you know, getting some, you know, good feelings. You know, I cannot, you know, say, I cannot, you know, give answer for them. So in this, you know, specific time, we can't say anything, we can't give any definition. I'm thinking like that.
Yeah, I think your artwork is the answer. And there are not many sculptors who have a doctorate in Sanskrit literature. And congratulations for that too.
It's my mother also asked me once, you have the PhD degree, why don't you go to college and join the, you know, that time it was in Kaladi, my university just started. Then all my friends, you know, went there and joined the department. But I thought, why I want money or my life? Life means satisfaction. I was teaching, but I couldn't enjoy the teaching. Here, early morning, go to school and, you know, just teaching and come back and with children at home. And then I have to sit with them for the homework. And again, I have to do some work for school. It was a hectic work for me. Then I thought, is it I'm living or working? My life, what is the meaning of my life? Then I was assistant of Ina. So then I liked the, you know, clay modeling and molding, and I learned all the techniques. Then I thought, why don't I do my own sculptures? You know, better than this school job. So then just switched off this sculpture.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Supriya, I think you have a lot to say after listening to Suneetha also. Yeah, you have to unmute yourself.
Hi. Yeah, I agree so much with Dr. Suneetha, because yes, as a woman, what we go through with family and the space that we have for us, that personal space of creating is something that connects us to that one, maybe that Premjish was talking in the beginning, you know, at that moment, the process of creating is the most important part. And after that you make, and then it moves on to wherever it needs to move. That I completely agree with. And also I also agree with the fact that how when I was a child, this thought just came to me, when I would go to Kerala, they'd say, tie your hair and put a slide on your hair, you know, and dress up, put on some gold, you know, you have to wear some gold. And I'm like, I don't want to do any of that. I want to be like me, what I can be. And I don't color my hair. And it's always said, why don't you color your hair and tie your hair? You know, this was, but I'm glad that that I was able to do what I can do and accept it for what I am, you know. It's like, also like, okay, cooking and cleaning, I went through it. And now my daughters are much older, you know, my older one is out of the home. My younger one is, as her birthday tomorrow, and she's also will be moving on very soon. And then it's me. And then the only thing I have is my studio, the space, you know, where I can work, where I can do what I want to do. But it takes time to reach that that point in life. And now I think I have a lot of that. And just create, you know, that is the only thing one can do, that I can do. And after that, it's out of my hands. But that process is great. And also like what home we Premjish was asking about, traveling in so many places, moving to so many places. What one did to me was I can be home anywhere. You know, I could be at home in the north, south, a village, an urban, a rural. And I feel at home as, you know, as long as I'm feeling confident. Sometimes my ex-husbands, when I used to visit the in-laws, you know, and my daughters were older, I would just take the cycle and say, I'm going to the farmer's market, but I would just go to the train station, park the cycle and take a train, which is just 15 minutes to Venice. And I would just walk in the streets, buy a sandwich and a beer from the supermarket, go to a little corner where there's nobody, sit there and just enjoy. And that is home for me, you know, that point that I could just, if somebody would give me a bed is also a home at the same time. It's the one place that I feel I can shut off my pain, my, you know, and I can be, and I don't have to allow anybody in that space, you know. Well, these are just little things, but I think they come a long way and help me in moving on. I hope that answers something.
This is more of a, like, we are not having an interview here. Like, this is more of a discussion.
Yeah. These are just random thoughts coming through about home, where one feels at home and creating.
True. No, I had asked this to Suneetha, and also redirected to you about flying. Has art given you a belonging, or it has unbelonged in some sense?
No, it has given me a belonging, a safety, an expression. To take something that is inside me that would make me go crazy otherwise. And yes, it has flown me to spaces that I had no idea it existed, you know.
Thank you all of you. Thanks for this wonderful, passionate talk. Thank you, Suneetha. Thank you, Supriya. Thank you, Manoj.
Thank you.
Thank you, Arun. Thank you, everyone, for joining. See you on 31st. We have our next panel discussion in the series with Unnikrishna Damodaran, Vipin Dhanurdharan, and Chitra EG on the 31st at 4:30 p.m.
Okay.